let me begin by telling you, I've been in the mental health field since 86. I was licensed in 88 to work with people. And as my career started in the mental health field, it came to focus on working with children and teenagers and adults with attention deficit disorder. And I think that's because for me, it was an easy move from where I had been before in my life. I was a baseball coach. I had played baseball at university level and done pretty well, I guess. And then coached at a university for 4 years. And during that time, what was great is my mentor, the man who was grooming me for more than university level baseball coaching, was Sparky Anderson. And Sparky would be at our field every January, every day till he went to spring training. And he mentored me. He would sit next to me in the dugout and talk baseball with me, talk coaching with me, sharpen my mind when it came to how baseball is played, at least the mathematics of baseball. And he taught me a lot. He taught me a lot about life and about gardening, which is what he was into, and about baseball and people and how to work with people. So I went from that into a few years later, coaching in Hawaii for a couple of years, and then back to go to graduate school. And after graduate school, yeah, I just was never the kind of therapist who would ask people, well, how does that make you feel? I just didn't care. What I cared about was how successful are people being, because knowing if they were going to be successful in what it is they wanted to do, they would feel great. So that just fit my personality more. So I went from private practice working with ADHD kids, people with problems with focusing attention, sustaining attention, being easily distracted, brain fades and so on, being impulsive, to working at a psychiatric hospital. I ran half a psychiatric hospital for a couple of years. The children's program, the adolescent psych and chemical dependency program, inpatient and outpatient work, and that was my kingdom for a couple of years. And then something happened. So I was running a support group for parents of ADD kids on the side as part of my job at the hospital. And one night there were about 120 parents in the room for the support group. And I was answering questions. I'd done my speech, I'd done my whatever to the parents, and they were asking me questions afterward. And this lady that I knew pretty well stood up and asked me, Doug, what do you think about this treatment for ADHD that was on TV yesterday out of Los Angeles called brainwave biofeedback treatment? A man was on there talking about this and said that it worked for most people without medication. What do you think about it? And in front of all of these people, I said, it doesn't work. And she asked, how do you know it doesn't work? And I actually said this. I said, because I know everything there is to know about the treatment of ADHD, and I don't know anything at all about this, so it doesn't work. And she was so great. And this was a lot of years ago, and I still remember this. And she said, Doug, we love you, but your ignorance of a subject does not make you an expert in that subject. And that was one of those turning points in life for me, where I humbly accepted that I was an idiot and I didn't know anything about it. So the next day, I called the man who was on TV, this man named Siegfried Othmer. And Siegfried and his wife, Susan, were popularizing, at the time, brainwave biofeedback treatment for ADHD and other kinds of problems. And Siegfried was very gracious. I told him the story. He said, yeah, we're having a training down here in about 10 days. Why don't you come down for the weekend and take a look for yourself, see what you think. So I did. I went down and met Siegfried. He had been a college professor at Cornell. He was a physics teacher at Cornell. And they had a son, Brian, who had a seizure disorder and didn't respond to medications, and it was just really bad. They heard about a guy named Barry Sturman in LA who was doing this brainwave biofeedback treatment, and he was teaching people how to stop having seizures. So they tried it, and it cured their son, Brian. So they quit. Susan quit as a nurse and Siegfried quit as a physics professor, and they started in this world of the electric activity of the human brain. Can you give the brain, the subject, information back quick enough that they can learn how to change and control their own brain? And Sturman was showing that this was possible, so they got into it. And there I was sitting in a room with a physics teacher teaching me that, yep, if you give people the right kind of feedback, they can change and control their own brainwave activity. So for me, that was step one, that as I went back into private practice, I had one of Siegfried's machines with me. And I worked with all kinds of people, chronic pain, seizure disorders, anxiety, but mostly ADHD, and easily 70% of the people that I worked with over the next couple of years improved dramatically. So that's where I started with what I will call in this video traditional neurofeedback. If you give the person enough information about what their brain's doing, they can learn how to change and control it. But that would take about 20 hours for people to really kind of get it, because it's like nothing else that you do to get how to change and control your own brainwave activity. But within about 40 hours of training, people were driving their brains pretty well. And it's from there that I met the next person in the story, Dr. Len Oakes. So I was in Palm Springs at a workshop, and I went to a workshop by this Dr. Len Oakes, and Len was talking about this new technology that he had developed, where he had taken traditional neurofeedback and married it with a device that gave mild stimulation through the eyes to the brain. It was a photic stimulation device that you can still buy at eBay or Amazon. They're kind of like brain toys. They're called sound and light machines. So he took the sound and light machine and the traditional neurofeedback and the amplifiers and the softwares, and he married them together so that instead of people taking 15 or 20 hours to learn how to drive their own brains and then doing the work for another 20 hours, that the subject's brain would talk directly to the software through the brainwaves, and then the software would send a small signal, in this case, back through little flickering lights and sunglasses, to tell the brain, to drive the brain, to loosen up the brain. The signal would come back a little faster, a little slower than the dominant brainwave activity. And so I got on as part of his research team. We're collecting data for the FDA because it's an FDA-approved medical device now. And in that work, we were seeing, I mean, I saw really amazing results, especially with people. If you look at everybody on a bell curve, this being peak performance over here and this being really messed up over here, that people on this side of the bell curve, it would shoot them really fast up to the top of the bell curve and then maybe over to the side a little bit, faster than the traditional neurofeedback could. So it was really amazing seeing people with these awful disorders, anxiety disorders, panic attacks, a girl who had been in this awful car accident and working with her and so on. So the worse the situation was, the faster it went to the middle of the bell curve. It was just amazing to see. And then Len called one day and he said, hey, put tape over the lights because the less stimulation, the better, okay? And then later he said, put cardboard over the lights because the less stimulation, the better. That's like less okay. And then somebody challenged him on that and said, there's just no way that this is working the way that you think it's working. And this pretty wealthy guy that Len was working with, his wife, for fibromyalgia, the guy writes Len a check for $100,000 and says, you go find out why this thing works, but it has nothing to do with these lights with the cardboard on them. And sure enough, it was the wire going from the amplifier up to the lights that would be on the person's shoulder and then up to the glasses. It was the tiny electric impulse coming out of that wire. That's the Livermore Labs up in Northern California. Discovered that. So Len just cut all the glasses off, threw them away, and just laid the wire over people's shoulders for a time. The brain was picking up that little teeny tiny subtle electrical energy. And so here we are years later, And now we'll put electrodes on people's forehead, and it goes through my amplifier. My software reads the dominant brainwave, sends a signal back, and this is all going on dozens of times every second. And the signal coming back is very mild. It's about 400 times less than the energy coming off of your cell phone or my cell phone. But it comes back in a radio wave that the brain picks up as a brain wave, slightly faster, slightly slower than its own dominant wave, driven by its own, by the brain itself. And so the brain sees it and responds to it very quickly, like quickly. So people don't have to learn anything. All they have to do is sit in my chair. That's all they got to do. And at the end of the first session, almost everybody says, oh my gosh, that's amazing. That's wonderful. What is going on here? And the brain is changing. We're getting changes in the parasympathetic nervous system. So people will say, I'm more relaxed, shoulders more relaxed, the hands are warm. There's more colors in the room, my vision's better. I mean, all these kinds of parasympathetic responses to this technology. Nothing works better that I'm aware of in the world at helping people who have post-concussion syndrome or traumatic brain injuries. Nothing works better. So UC San Diego is involved in a study right now using gear supplied by IASIS, Microcurrent in Temecula, with the Veterans Administration. 200 veterans is the goal. 200 veterans with a dual diagnosis of PTSD and traumatic brain injury, like from a concussive blast or whatever. Because in the preliminary study, they got 6 out of 6 guys made huge differences, improvements in symptoms by 50% or more in just 6 sessions. And that's measured by over-the-top, state-of-the-art brain monitoring stuff at UC San Diego. So Dr. Huang is doing that. He'll release his studies sometime this year, 2021, and they'll probably end up, I'm going to guess, with like 180 veterans. But the VA wrote a huge check to pull off this study with this exact gear. Works really great for everybody who comes into my office with a central nervous system issue. I mean, like 90% of the people who come into my office. Panic attacks, anxiety, ADHD, depression, head injuries. I mean, sometimes bad head injuries. So what we envision doing with athletes is starting off with this technology, and where they may have had a concussion in the past, the brain will kind of get stuck there, or where they might have anxiety, brain gets stuck, trauma in the past, whether it's a blow to the head or whether it's severe emotional trauma or loss, brain kind of gets stuck in performance. So this loosens up the brain so it has much more clarity of thought, much more freedom in operation, being able to go from brain state much easier, and kicks in that parasympathetic nervous system. And it happens pretty quickly. So then that would allow us to move to the next thing, which is back to traditional neurofeedback training, where you learn how to drive your own brain. So in wanting to work with athletes for peak performance training, it brings me back full circle, back to the traditional neurofeedback that's a learning, kind of neurofeedback, where we give you information about what your brain's doing, and then you learn how to drive your own brain after a period of time. So I started researching that, knowing that for my clinical practice, the direct neurofeedback was helping 90% of the people that came into my office. But to want to do peak performance training, wanted something more focused on that. So through the years, I've followed the work of a number of different neurofeedback guys, but one in particular, because his name is Jonathan Cowan, C-O-W-A-N, same as my last name, Dallas's last name. So it, you know, it perks your attention to see that. So I followed his work for years, and he had been to the National Institute of Health, working more in the peak performance field. And so all that means is that he was creating these filters. Like one would be a filter for the front part of the head. When it's focused and concentrating, you get positive feedback for that. And so you learn how to focus from the front part of your brain better, and how to use the attention network about here in the brain better to focus and concentrate on small things. So he created a filter for that. And then he created another filter for alertness, awareness. Situational awareness is probably a better word for that. It's the idea of if you're walking through a jungle and you know there are predators out there, but you're also trying to look for a treasure and you're really aware of what's going on around you, that's a different brain state. So he created a filter for that brain state. So you can, anything you get information from about your brain, you can learn how to change and control it and do it better. So they had that filter, had a filter that worked just with that, the dopamine receptor sites in the brain, but it was driven from, let me know when I bore you, it was driven from the 40 hertz frequencies driven by the thalamus in the brain, which is kind of a binding rhythm. So I had just read a year ago in a book about flow states with X game athletes and how that when they're actually performing, they kind of turn off the front of the brain called hypofrontality, and they make alpha and theta brainwaves, but on those brainwaves are these 40 hertz gamma waves. Well, John Cowan had made a filter 20 years ago to teach the brain how to make more of these 40 hertz gamma waves. So I knew what he had done was ideal for peak performance training. I mean, off the hook kind of peak performance training. So I started really researching that, and I noticed his technology had been used over the years. U.S. Olympic Committee, West Point Military Academy in their Performance Enhancement Center when Louis Soka was there. And a number of professional golfers coming out of Australia using it. People will fly from Korea down to Australia to get trained with certain golf coaches there. And so I'm looking at all of this, how it's been used in business and so on. Louis Soka was at West Point, and then he went into business, and he was working with Fortune 500 companies, setting up brain labs and using this technology with them. He passed away, I guess, a year ago or two. So the more I looked into this thing that the military was using to train tank commanders in how to survive combat, I thought probably pretty good. And this has a 30-foot range to it. So I can record your brainwave activity. You can be 29 feet away from my computer. And I can record your brainwaves. So that means we can put you on a putting green and we can monitor your brainwaves as you are going through that cycle, the putting cycle, noticing your target, selecting where you want the ball to go into the cup, the path to get the ball there, you're focusing on the ball, back to the target, back to the ball, your backswing, and your stroke. And we can measure your brainwave activities, and there really is, for each athlete, and for golfers in general, there's kind of a cycle that's ideal. That imagine this, that the golfer would start with big focus, being aware of his situation as he approaches the golf ball. Then he selects his target, small focus, and he imagines not just the target, but also the result that he wants as he selects the target. And then back to situational awareness, and then focusing small on the golf ball, and then back to the target, back to the golf ball. Each one of these is a switch from one brain state to another brain state, and each of those brain states can be trained. So if the brain is flexible in performance from the direct neurofeedback, then it can go from small focus to big focus to small focus to big focus. And then, now, David Ledbetter's Academy down in Florida and Wes Syme out of University of Nebraska, peak performance guy there. So they did a study looking at the difference between 15 handicapped golfers or worse and professional golfers in this cycle, brainwave cycle. And what they found was that with the professional golfers, just before they start their backswing, they actually turn their brain off. Well, it's this hypofrontality. So they turn off the front part of the brain. And the golf coach in your head goes, the ego goes, the future goes, the past goes. It's just quiet in your head as they execute a shot they've practiced 10,000 times. That can all be measured and trained by using this gear. That's why I selected this particular software program from this particular software writer, scientist, brain scientist guy. So that's what we have that are the primary tools that we have. So direct neurofeedback, very powerful, very powerful. It all by itself would do 90% of what we want to do. 75% of what we want to do. And then the peak achievement trainer is what it's called, or Cowan calls it other names, but it really is focused on teaching those three things: small focus, situational awareness, and hypofrontality. It's like when you're shooting a free throw. You ever notice that? When you're shooting a free throw, that there's a point where you turn your brain off and everything just quiet, but you're totally aware, totally focused. It's like that feeling. All of that can be trained. And so we can actually take a guy out to the putting green. We can record his brain waves and train them in the office setting, in a lab setting, go out to the putting green, record his brain waves, back to the lab setting, say, this is what you do, let's train you to do different, better, back out to the putting green, back into the lab. And so there's a variety of that, a variety of cycles like that, whether you're playing defensive back in the National Football League or whether you're playing offensive lineman in the National Football League. There's going to be a different cycle to that. One of the things about hypofrontality that's like the little hidden secret, when the front part of the brain is really working, you have a coach inside your head, stalking. You have thoughts about the future. You have thoughts about the past. Your ego is involved in it. And a number of other things. You're trying to figure stuff out. You tend to hesitate. That's why hypofrontality is important. You don't hesitate to just do what you've been trained to do. But also strength. So they looked at weightlifters and they saw that when the front part of the brain was engaged, weightlifters were lifting like 65% of what they were really capable of lifting. But when they went in this hypofrontality state, there was no ego, no coach, and people were lifting like 80 to 85% of what they were, you know, physically capable of doing before all their bones broke. So they know there's something about going in this hypofrontality state that it truly is a peak performance state because there's this sort of abandon to it. This not reckless abandon, well-trained abandon, but this explosiveness that is just, you know, can only be found in that state. X game athletes understand this, skiers understand this. The acrobatic skiers do this all the time. That's what they want. With any contact sport, we can work to fix head injuries, post-concussive syndrome, make the brain work better, also help people so when they retire, they still got a brain, you know, into their 70s, 80s, and 90s, and not into their 40s and 50s. Wendell Tyler's got a great interview on this. He works with Dubin down in LA. So does, I can't think of his name. Anyway, guy used to be a lineman for the 49ers, and they're in their 50s now. Tyler's probably in his 60s. And his wife was talking about how Wendell would take grandkids to school and couldn't remember which kid he dropped off at which school or how to find his way home. And that's just not right for a guy who was like an icon in Los Angeles for so many years. So, I mean, this helps with that. The direct neurofeedback can help athletes from contact sports with that. It helps anybody with aging, but especially people who have had concussions and numerous little teeny tiny blows to the head like you do in every football practice in high school and college and professional football. All of those add up. All of them are problematic as we age. So the direct neurofeedback's awesome for that. And then the peak achievement trainer for the active right now, I'm going to hit this golf shot. The act of right now, I'm going to make this play, I'm going to make this catch. The explosiveness, the responsiveness, certainly applications for baseball players, pretty much any sport. Gamers, yeah, I've already bought the domain names. As the gaming industry gets bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, these two brain technologies are going to be really important.